Holy Week and Easter. We are very grateful that Wayne Marshall has made this possible and that Father Peter and I are able to come, and of course keeping our social distance, in order that this Mass can be sent to you at home. Wayne has also recorded some hymns for Passion Week and for Holy Week, and we hope that whilst watching these videos you will be able to make your spiritual communion and be present with us in heart, mind and spirit. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
For the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My friends, in order to make our confession before these sacred mysteries begin, let us call to mind our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all what is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Most merciful God, who by the death and the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, delivered and saved the world, grant that by faith in him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of his victory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from St. Paul's letter to the Romans. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, and to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, if the Spirit of God really dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although your bodies are dead because of sin, your spirits are alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit which dwells in you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm is 130, and the response, with the Lord there is mercy and plenteous redemption.
With the Lord
there is
mercy
and plenteous
redemption.
Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who should stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revealed. With the Lord there is mercy and plenteous redemption. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. With the Lord there is mercy and plenteous
redemption.
O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities. With the Lord there is mercy and plenteous redemption.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Hear the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when he heard it, Jesus said, this illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of Man may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then, after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you. And are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right. Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, Let us also go, that we may die with him. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away. Many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. Jesus said to her, Your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, The teacher is here and is calling for you. And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, Where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, See how he loved him. But some of them said, Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, Take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, Unbind him and let him go. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I was used to think that this was a very peculiar gospel to have at this point. It's a bit like a novel or a story when the climax, and if you've read it before, you know, is about to happen. In this case, Jesus is going to be arrested, crucified, and then he will rise again. But why, a couple of chapters earlier, have the same thing, apparently, happen to some friend of his? Isn't that going to spoil the climax of the story? Isn't it a bit tactless to have this story about Lazarus just at this point? Well, those of you who read my little meditation on John's Gospel, the healing of the blind man from birth, last week, which was sent out to you by Father Simon, will know that St. John was not terribly concerned with facts as such. Now, there was a friend called Lazarus, and a friend, maybe it was Lazarus, was brought back from the dead by Jesus. But was it like this? Was it at this point? We don't know. And anyway, John was not really concerned with that. You know, in New Testament times, facts were not such an obsession as they are now. The deeper meaning, the spiritual meaning of what happens or what is recounted is really the point of the gospel passage. And this is particularly true in John. His community, cut off from the other communities of Mark, Luke, and Matthew, possibly in Greece, certainly a long time after the other Gospels were written, as I said, possibly the end of the first century or the beginning of the second, wanted to keep and preserve their special insights into the life of Jesus, which possibly came from a disciple who fled after Jesus' death and settled in this place, perhaps on a Greek island. He wanted to remind us, or indeed, perhaps, not even remind us, but to tell us that Jesus was not simply a miracle worker, and the blind man from birth being cured was a miracle, and so indeed was the raising of Lazarus. He was not just a miracle worker, he was the Son of God. And so this passage really goes to town, if you like, in overemphasizing the power which Jesus had as the Son of God, as one who was absolutely in touch with the Father, with God the Father. It's emphasized even to the extent that Jesus doesn't go and cure Lazarus while he is alive, which he possibly could have done, but he waits for 2 days, it is said. In order to make the point that he has the power over life and death. And just to rub it in, we have that wonderful comment by Martha, "Lord, there is already a stench because he's been dead 4 days. I mean, come on, what are you doing, man?" Yes, he wanted us to realize that this man was truly dead. And yet, Jesus gives him life. And if we look at this passage, and indeed these 45 verses in relation to the whole chapter, we see that what comes next is the ever near event of Jesus' arrest and death. So this passage is, above all things, about life. It's actually preparing us, and in the story of the gospel, preparing the disciples and the friends, and even those Jews who believe, preparing us for what is to come. This is life, Jesus says. Communion with me, friendship with me. Your brother will rise again. Now, not just on the last day, but now, and because, as Jesus says in that wonderful verse, which I'm sure many of us learnt as children and have remembered ever since, probably in the Authorized Version, but anyway, those wonderful words, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Well, how apt those words are to everyone, but particularly to we Christian believers in this time of anxiety and crisis. We have to believe that by being in communion with God through Jesus, we will live, that we are living, that we are part of God's eternal plan here and now at this very moment. Yes, of course, we will rise at the last day, but we can rise now above our anxieties and our fears. We can rise in our faith in the one who gives life. And that's what this passage is all about. John wants us to be reassured, even though very soon the disciples and those who followed Jesus were going to come to the brick wall of his death. Still, they must believe, as we must, because Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Do not despair. Although there is a stink from the tomb, do not despair. Whomsoever believeth in me shall not perish, but have everlasting life here and now in communion with God through the sacraments, through the fellowship of the church, through the scriptures, through prayer and meditation. That is God's promise to us now. Holy Catholic Church throughout the world, and especially for the Anglican Communion. We pray for Justin, our Archbishop. We pray for Robert and David, our bishops. We pray for Archbishop Charles. We pray for Pope Francis and all those who bear the responsibility of guiding the Church. through this time of crisis and trial. We pray for Father Simon, for Father Peter, for Father Francois, for our reader Michael, for all those who serve in the sanctuary, who are on the church council, and especially for our wardens, for Simon and Bernice. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for the leaders of the world, and especially Lord George, President of Malta, and Robert Abella, and for all those who bear responsibility here in this time of crisis, for all who work for the common good. We pray too for Elizabeth, Queen and Head of the Commonwealth. We pray for Boris and all those in government in the United Kingdom, and those who bear responsibility in all the nations of the world from which we have come or where we have association or connection. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for all those who are looking after the sick, all those who are investigating vaccines and other drugs which may be useful against the coronavirus, for scientists and researchers. Pray for all those particularly on the front line, for the doctors and nurses at our hospitals here in Malta, and in the UK, and in the countries of our connection or origin. We pray too for those who are sick, for any who are afflicted at this time with the virus, for those who are anxious or concerned, who are lonely, who are worried, and who are becoming ill or sick. We pray particularly for Noy, Michael, Brian, Peter Louis, priest, Michele, Aldo, Sandra, Margaret, Alex, Bernadette, Cameron, Gina, Colin, Jeff and Jean, Linda, and also for our friends, Marie-Louise, and especially at this time for Sandra Wood. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for courage and for faith. We pray that we may remember that we are sons and daughters of the living Lord, that we may be locations of hope, of support, of selflessness, of responsibility at this time. We pray for our neighbours and our neighbourhood. We pray particularly for those who are on their own, those who have no one to look after them, and we pray that we will do what we can safely and responsibly to show that as servants of the servant Lord, we care and we love them. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for all those who have died, particularly those who have died as a result of the coronavirus. We pray too for those whose anniversary of death is at this time. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
May light perpetual shine upon them.
May they rest in peace.
Amen.
Let us join together, asking the prayers of Our Lady and all the saints, saying, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Rejoicing in the fellowship of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Paul, St. George, and all the saints, we commend ourselves and the whole of creation to your unfailing love, saying, Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed be you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May
the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands
for the praise and glory of his name,
for our good and the good of his church. Almighty God, may the sacrifice we offer take away the sins of those whom you enlighten with the Christian faith. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. As a man like us, Jesus wept for Lazarus, his friend. As the eternal God, he raised Lazarus from the dead. In his love for us all, Christ goes out to bring us his sacramental healing, to lift up us to everlasting life. Through him, the angels of heaven offer their prayer of adoration as they rejoice in your presence forever. May our voices be one with theirs in their triumphant hymn of praise.
Holy, 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 holy Lord,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna
in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this anamnesis of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice, we bring before you these holy gifts, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share these holy gifts, so that we, in the company of Our Lady, St. Paul, St. George, St. Lazarus, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray with confidence, Father, in the words our Saviour taught us. Our Father,
which
art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom,
the power, and the glory are yours,
now and forever, Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you,
and with your spirit.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Mighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Almighty Father, by this sacrifice, may we always remain one with your Son, Jesus Christ, whose body and blood we share. For he is the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Will the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord, protect your people always, that they may be free from every evil and all malice, and serve you with all their hearts. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
The Mass has ended. Go in peace. To love and to serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.